Now, as a science or ecology student, we all know that the India has been divided into different biogeographic zones, and the Ganga, it passes through three biogeographic. I'm talking about the main stem Ganga River, which passes through the Himalayas in the state of Uttarakhand. Then it passes through the Gangetic Plain, which is in the state of UP, and the state of Bihar, and then a little bit part of Deccan Peninsula in the state of Jharkhand. And again, when it ends this Bengal state, it covers the Gangetic Plain as well as the coast. Now, this has resulted in extraordinary variations in altitude, because when you go to Himalayas, it's about 7,000 or 6,000 meters. Then it comes to the sea level, it is low meters above sea. And because of that, there is a wide variation in climate. Because of these two factors, there is wide variation in land use, and flora and fauna, they are obviously different in these biogeographic zones also. And humans' lifestyle, it gets woven around the land use and climate and altitude. That's why social and cultural life also varies as we pass from Himalayas to the Bay of Bengal. And Ganga River was declared as a national river on 20 February 2009. When we talk about biodiversity profile, we have about 5 species of aquatic mammals. Here I'm talking only about species which are dependent on the river. We are not species that are associated with the Ganga River and its basin. So we have 5 species of aquatic mammals, which include 2 species of dolphins and 3 species of otters. We have 177 species of aquatic birds, 27 species of reptiles, 11 species of amphibians, and about 378 species of fishes. Of these, about 6 species are critically endangered according to IUCN's Red List, which include the Gangetic shark and 3 subspecies of Batagur turtle species. Then we have Gharial, which is critically endangered, and Bear's Poacher, which is a bird, is also critically endangered. Then we have about 11 endangered species, which include the dolphin, both dolphin species, and then we have about 18 vulnerable species. And again, this is only for the main stem of Ganga River. Now, in layman's terminology and sometimes scientist terminology also, we say that the Ganga is divided into upper stretch, which is in the Himalayas again, then the middle stretch, which is from Haridwar till Banaras, and the lower stretch, which is from Banaras till Nurpur, where it joins the Bay of Bengal. So whenever I'll be talking about Ganga River, I'll be talking about in terms in upper stretch, middle stretch, and the lower stretch. As you can see here, and if you recall the previous slide, we say that the upper stretch is basically the Himalayas, the middle and the lower combination of Gangetic Plains and a little bit of coastal areas. This is the origin of Ganga River, which is the Gombuk, from where Ganga starts its journey. As you can see, the landscape is barren with limited trees. Or you can say it's a trans-Himalayan landscape. Here we don't have many aquatic species except for the fish species. Then we have this iconic plant, which is known as the Brahma Kamal, which is offered only to the Vishnu form or incarnation of Vishnu, and it is only through some priest they are allowed to pluck these flowers, and nobody else is allowed to pluck these flowers. So you can see the landscape is associated with the cultural region also. Then this is blue sheep that is found at high altitude, and this picture here shows that Here, this figure is Ganga, goddess Ganga, and here these four figures are the crocodile, which tells us about the mythological story that Ganga was brought to earth on the back of a ghadiyal or a makar. As you must have noticed on the first or introductory slide of my presentation. So the upper stretch is, or Upper Ganga is about 294 kilometer, which starts from Gomukh and till Haridwar. So till from Gomukh to Haridwar, Ganga River has very turbulent flow with high velocity, and the habitat is very stony and it is intermingled with pebbles and sand. Because the flow is high, there are limited nutrients and limited phytoplanktons, and obviously limited aquatic plants. And fish, it predominates the aquatic food chain. Now, if you concentrate on this photograph, which is on the slide right now, you will see there is two clear distinct, the color of two rivers is clearly different from each other. One of them is the Alaknanda River and the other one is the Bhagirathi River. And both join Devprayag, which is the confluence. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, ma'am.
Okay. It's a little difficult when you are doing it online.
yeah.
Because you don't get to see the faces of the participants, no?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yeah, audio, ma'am.
So, okay, thank you. So here you can see that the color of the water is very distinct. These are the Alaknanda and the Bhagirathi rivers, which join at the Devprayag, and the Bhagirathi river, which originates at the Gomukh Glacier, whereas Alaknanda has an origin near Badrinath. You must all have heard about Badrinath, another pilgrimage site. So this is for one of the first Panch Prayags, and from here the actual Ganga starts. As I said, some of other non-aquatic or terrestrial faunal species which are found in the upper stretch of the Ganga River, or basically the Trans-Himalayan stretch of the Ganga River, which include the blue sheep, the iconic snow leopard, ibex, and fishes, snow trout is one of the fish which is a representative or iconic fish of this particular stretch. And this snow trout is a cold water fish. It cannot thrive above 25 degrees centigrade. It lives in cold water and shallow streams. And when you come down from Trans-Himalaya to the Himalayan range, then you find this kind of landscape with Himalayan thar, musk deer, black bear, and small clawed otter amongst the terrestrials. Not the small clawed otter, but the other species as terrestrial species, and small clawed otter as an aquatic species. Then we have monal and tragopan as iconic bird species in this kind of habitat. Then we come down a little more towards Haridwar or Rishikesh. Those who must have visited these areas, they would be knowing that after Devprayag, where the confluence of Alaknanda and Bhagirathi, the river becomes a little calm and it starts expanding in terms of its width. Otherwise, in the Himalayas, the width is very narrow. But after Devprayag, the width starts increasing, so the depth also starts increasing and water temperature also starts changing. In this particular stretch, we have Golden Mahasi, which is the iconic fish species of this region. And then we have Asian otter, which are found in this stretch. Now, after looking at this, we know what kind of benefits we would be getting from the Ganga River. We use the river for fishing. We obviously use this region for generation of electricity. So hydropower is one of the major benefits that we get from the Ganga River here. Then we get water supply for domestic as well as industrial use, as well as agricultural use in this particular region. And in terms of tourism, which is the topic of the webinar which is going on, this place has a lot to offer in terms of religion, tourism, and adventure tourism. Then when we go from upper stretch to the middle stretch, this is the kind of which emerges. This is Haridwar, from where the middle stretch joins in. So right now this place doesn't look like this because of the lockdown and coronavirus, obviously. Otherwise it's full of people all throughout. Then when we move a little ahead, you see a lot of barrages on the Ganga River, which are actually diverting water from the Ganga River for agricultural purposes. Then you see lots of braids, river getting braided, and lot of here you can see a lot of islands here. And along these islands, a lot of people, they do agriculture on these islands. These all are not natural plants. These are agriculture of the crops that they've grown on this. Then Saras crane is the iconic species for middle stretch. And then you reach Banaras, Varanasi, where again similar kind of thing, religious offerings and all happen throughout the day. So the middle stretch is effectively from Haridwar till Banaras, and the river bed is flat. The river has dynamic system of pools and rivulets, and here water is diverted for agriculture at three major places. At Upper Ganga, as and these canals are named as Upper Ganga, Middle Ganga, or Madhya Ganga, and Lower Ganga canal, accordingly, according to their location. And flow water, when you are diverting water, some water has to remain in the river so that the river is called a river. So some water is joins the river through feeder canal and also from other smaller tributaries such as Ram Ganga and a larger tributary as Yamuna River. So this is middle stretch. Now the lower stretch has similar kind of landscape as the middle stretch, with river even widening a lot. So when it reaches the state of West Bengal, the river could be more than 1 kilometer wide. Our survey teams have been lost many times because they could not see the bank, either banks, and they have lost many times. So this is one of the places in Jharkhand where you can read Wildlife Institute of India here. These are our, these local people are our Ganga Praharis, or the part of local communities who are part of Ganga Conservation Initiative. So they keep the banks and ghats clean, and they all are actively helping us in rescue and release of aquatic species which are accidentally caught in the fishing net, or during high flood they get into the agricultural lands. So when you move towards West Bengal, this kind of landscape appears with a lot of reeds appearing on the banks of the Ganga River. So lower stretch is effectively Varanasi downstream till Ganga reaches the Bay of Bengal. And Ganga receives water from the perennial rivers originating in the Himalayas, such as Kosi, Gandak and Ghagra, the major rivers. And perennial rivers fed by precipitation and groundwater. And there are some seasonal rivers also, which originate in southern Shivaliks. This, again, like the middle stretch, has alluvial basin. And unlike the middle Ganga, I would like to specify here that unlike the middle Ganga, this lower stretch has paddle influx from sea because of the Bay of Bengal. So when there was no Farakka barrage, tidal influx could be seen till Banaras. That's why the lower stretch starts from Banaras. And this Hilsa fish, which is a delicacy amongst the Bengalis, used to be found till Banaras or Allahabad also because of the tidal influx. But Farakka barrage, it stopped upward migration of the Hilsa River. So again, these are some of the representative species and habitat from the middle and the lower Ganga. To some extent, till Haridwar, Masi were found here. So I've included that also. Ghadiyal is another iconic species which is critically endangered, which is found in the middle stretch. And it is of the 14. Today is also the World Crocodile Day. So India has, after the 14 crocodile species, India has 3 crocodile species. And Ghadiyal is the one which is critically endangered. And in India, there's a small population of Ghadiyals in along the Chambal River and along the Ganga River, especially near Hastinapur Wildlife Sanctuary, which is near Aligarh and Meerut. And then we have Magar, we have smooth-coated otters. Again, we have 13 species of turtles here and two species of dolphins. Okay, coming to dolphin, which is also a national aquatic animal of India. Dolphin only live or prefer deep waters. So in earlier 1800 centuries, dolphin would be found till Haridwar, but after the construction of Bijnor Barrage, which is down Haridwar, the upward migration of dolphin has stopped. So the dolphins are not sighted now near Haridwar, but they are sighted beyond Bijnor Barrage. And there are 13 species of turtle, of which one species is estuarine turtle, Batugarbaska. Then there are some iconic bird species here. The black-bellied tern, Sarah crane, Indian skimmer, the river tern, and the thick-knee. And when you reach Bay of Bengal, along the mangroves, this is the kind of habitat that you see with reeds, and this Royal Bengal tiger. This is the estuarine crocodile, and this is the Northern River Terrapin or Batugarbaska, which is an estuarine turtle. Then again, we have a small clawed otter here. Now, this Middle Ganga and Lower Ganga have similar kind of geomorphology. That's why the services or benefits that we get from middle and lower stretches are almost similar also. So, we have fishing here. We have agriculture here, you have reed collection and water supplies there, and again tourism is also here because we have Banaras and other major cities also, which are religiously important. Then another benefit that I have not mentioned here is transportation. As you can see on the screen, where the river is used as for transportation by local people, and this Ganga River from Haldia till Allahabad is also the first national waterway of India, and it is being promoted for that, for ferrying larger ships and all. Now, what about the benefits that we get from the Ganga River? The benefits can be grouped into provisioning services, which is where you use the benefits. For example, you drink the water, or you use the water for your agriculture field, or you use the water for livestock or industries. Then you get food from the Ganga River in form of fishes and aquatic plants. Then we get non-timber forest produce, such as grasses, reeds for making thatches, bamboos, then medicinal plants. And apart from that, another important material that we get from any river, these services we get from any river. Only the scale of or the amount of services that we things that we withdraw from the river would vary. So we also get sand and boulders, which are used for construction. Among other provisioning services are the non-consumptive services, where you take out the benefits without consuming the water. So hydropower is one of the provisioning service that we get from river, where we produce the or generate the electricity and get put the water back into the river. And again, in transportation, we are not using the water, but we are using it as a mode. So these are some of the provisioning services. Then there's another group of services, that is the cultural services that we get from any river. But for Ganga River specifically, we get we have cultural services in form of tourism. There's religion or spiritual services. There is aesthetic service, and there are a lot of heritage sites along the Ganga River. Ganga River is also known as Ganga Jamuna Tehzeeb. So a lot of Mughal buildings from the Mughal Empire time you can see along the Ganga River also. But how about these services? The services which the Ganga River provides is of maintaining population and habitat for all the aquatic as well as terrestrial species. The water in the Ganga River helps in regulation of microclimate. the normal flow of the Ganga River or any river, as a matter of fact, it helps increase soil fertility or basically interaction or ecological processes among these microorganisms as well as vertebrate. They help in increasing soil fertility. It also helps in soil formation. The soil from the upstream is deposited downstream, and with that, nutrient is also transported up from upstream to downstream. Water purification and waste management is another service that we get from the Ganga River. How do we get that? Okay. So, when the water, it percolates, see, we have to think of a river in terms of a larger system. River, we cannot think of as a linear system. If we think of a river as a linear system, we will not be able to visualize all these services. So we have to think of river along with its riverbank, along with the wetlands that are associated with the river, and also along with the seasonal flow or flooding or drought of the river. So when rain falls and it percolates down, and if there is vegetation or forest or aquatic vegetation along the banks of the Ganga River, the water gets purified and it percolates down to the river. Further, these animals that I mentioned so far, especially the aquatic animals, turtles, they clean up the Ganga River naturally, or any river wherever they live. They clean up the debris, they recycle that debris and use that as a nutrient. So they help in water purification and waste management. So when we talk about these services, we have to look at a whole in a bigger picture. And again, because of the same process, water, the river also plays an important part of in water cycle. And as we all know, the recent cyclones along the Bay of Bengal and also in the Mumbai area, we got to know that we have always known that mangroves, they help in protection, or they provide some degree of protection from storm or cyclones. So I would rather term this as not benefits from Ganga River, but as ecosystem services and goods of Ganga River. So can do all these three stretches of the river, the middle, upper and the lower, do they provide similar level of services to us? No. The level, the scale, the level or the quantity, and also the quality of services, it varies with the stretch, because as I told earlier that these stretches means different biogeographic zone, different assemblages of species, and different assemblages of species means different level or different biophysical processes through which these species interact. So the level of services will also vary. First, and the other thing also is that because of topography, the services will also differ. For example, in the upper Ganga, drinking water use is not very much from the Ganga River. Why from the Ganga River? Because in the upper Himalayas or upper Ganga, we have a lot of small streams, either rain-fed or snow-fed. So people don't directly depend on the Ganga River itself, but on those small streams or natural springs that are near their villages. But in middle and lower Ganga, people have no option but to get the water from the Ganga River. Again, for domestic use, people from the upper Ganga has little use of the water from for domestic purpose. But in the middle and lower Ganga, people are totally dependent on water from Ganga River. When you come to agriculture, there isn't agriculture in agriculture does happen in the upper stretch, but that is mainly rain fed. People don't use or irrigate their fields as per se. But in the middle Ganga and the lower Ganga, which is the hot spots of, which is the food bowl of our country, just a second, coffee. Sorry, please take off. Okay, sorry. So people do agriculture in the upper stretch, but that agriculture is not at a large scale or commercial scale. It's for self-reliance, basically. But in Middle Ganga and Lower Ganga, which is the food bowl of the country, people or farmers, they're dependent totally on Ganga River for irrigation. Then again, for livestock, there isn't much use in Upper Ganga, but Middle and Lower Ganga, livestock are totally dependent on the river water from the Ganga. There aren't many industries in Upper Ganga, so not much use. But in Middle Ganga and Lower Ganga, there are many industries located right along the bank of the Ganga River, and they use water from the Ganga River for the carrying out their operation. Now, coming to non-consumptive use of water, which is power generation, Upper Ganga provides maximum hydropower. Lot many dams are situated in the upper stretch or the Himalayan stretch, and a lot many repercussions in terms of ecology has occurred because of presence of these large dams. They have stopped the migratory routes of the fishes, which is the main representative or major fauna of that particular region. Then we have small scale nuclear and thermal power plants in the Middle and Lower Ganga. We don't use Upper Ganga for transportation because of rough patches. It's only for kayaking and those kind of sports, that water river rafting we use that for. But in Middle Ganga and Lower Ganga, transportation is one of the major use. I will not go through it entirely, but if you want to ask me some particular question, you can always revert back to me at the end of this. Now, what are the challenges for mainstreaming these benefits from Ganga River? We know Ganga River is there. We know there are benefits. So why can't, what is the problem in that? First problem is that there is limited understanding of the stock and flow concept. Stock basically is the, we need to first understand that these services are there because there is an ecological process which is going behind, and these services and are an outcome or the flow outcome of these ecosystem processes. So stock is the ecosystem and the processes or the interaction between different levels of food chain or food web, and flow is the resultant service in form of good and even request value or presence value. Then we have limited understanding of river, how river flows, what is the biota, and what are the ecosystem processes. It is still at a very nascent stage. We are still trying to understand this. And ecosystem processes are site specific because the processes or ecosystem function, they are temperature dependent, they are species dependent, and they are dependent on other factors, abiotic factors. Then other challenges is that, again, as I said earlier, there are varied landscapes with varied ecosystems. So, and other important thing is these ecosystem services are off-site in nature. Off-site means, as I told you earlier, that when you talk about soil sedimentation or soil nutrient, the upper stretch, when water flows from the upper stretch at high speed, it reaches the middle stretch and the lower stretch at a lower speed. So when the water flows from upper stretch at high speed, it carries with it the sediments and the nutrient. So sediments and nutrient, the benefit of those nutrients are not being taken by the local community which are upstream, but rather than the communities which are downstream. Similarly, water purification function of the vegetation along the banks of Ganga, the local people will not be able to get direct benefit out of it. Rather than people living downstream of those forests and those rivers, they will be getting that benefit. So here in this table, I've given some examples. For example, water for drinking in agriculture. Its origin is upstream, the communities that will be benefited will be people who are living in close proximity and as well as regional and at national level. Let's say, for example, the water from the Ganga River is diverted at Rishikesh, so starting at Rishikesh, and the water reaches people of Haryana and UP and New Delhi. Similarly, if you look at Yamuna River, the water, the Hathinikund barrage made in Haryana diverts the water for drinking for people in New Delhi. So the community which is getting benefit apart from local communities, it's the community at the national level or regional level. Similarly, soil sedimentation. Similarly, is the case with the electricity generation. The electricity that is generated in the Himalayan stretch of Ganga River is usually transported or transmitted to people living in the NCR region. So the scope of communities getting benefited is larger than the origin. But in case of transportation, because it's a non-consumptive use, unlike other services, here the origin is local and the communities benefited are also local. In case of tourism, origin is always local, but the communities that are benefited are local, national, as well as international. I forgot to mention it here. It also benefits international people. Now, as one of the main challenge, I would say, is choosing between the ecosystem services. Why do we need to choose? Can we not get all the benefits at the same time? Well, no, we cannot get benefits, all the benefits at the same time. For example, if we are giving away water too much of water for agriculture, what will happen? There will be no water left in the river. And as a result, other ecosystem processes of the rivers will not be completed and other services will be diminished. So there are particular services which appear together. So we call them synergies. For example, these are the services which appear together and they have synergistic association with each other. Maintaining population and habitat is one of the services which is associated with nature and culture tourism. Again, it is associated with soil fertility, water cycling, sediment deposition, microclimate regulation. These are just few of them which are for showing you that what synergy means, I have shown here. So then when we talk about trade-off, for example, when we extract riverbed material in form of sand and boulders, then if we remove too much sand and boulders, it would impact habitat of microorganisms. Those organisms which live underneath the boulders, big boulders and sand, their habitat will be destroyed. So there has to be a balance. So here we have to make a trade-off. Either we would be able to maintain population or habitat, or we will be able to get riverbed material. Similarly, there are other trade-offs also. If we take away too much of water for irrigation and livestock, there won't be any water left for maintaining soil fertility or sand deposit, sediment deposition, or even for maintaining population and habitat. And then forget about tourism at all, because there will be no water, there will be no forest, there would nobody be visiting those barren areas. Nobody would be interested in that. So when we talk about synergies and trade-off, there's also a debate about immediate versus long-term benefit. When we talk about riverbed material or navigation or power generation, irrigation or agriculture industry, these all are immediate benefits. But maintaining population habitat, nature and culture tourism, sand deposition, climate regulation, these are long-term benefits. They don't happen overnight. Unlike riverbed material, you go and take a truck full of riverbed material and go away. But in case of these synergistic services, they don't happen overnight. It happen over certain time period, and that time period, we are yet to find out those time period. That's why I said understanding of these things is incomplete. So our science is also incomplete in this matter. Now, the example that I was giving you of agriculture, if we want to make a trade-off between water for agriculture or conservation, because of dams, what happens? There have structural changes happen along the river, hydrology is altered, and pollutants remain in the water for long. Otherwise, river has the capacity of cleaning itself through these ecological processes or functions. So when we build a dam here, we are making two types of scenarios here. We are stopping the flow of the river, and we are creating puddle or pool or deep pools upstream of those dams, and whereas downstream of those dams there is no water or very less water. So in case of this, because of this, these dams, 70% of Bhagirathi River or 48% of Alaknanda River, they are either inundated or they are diverted. In this picture here, this is upstream of Haridwar and this is downstream of Haridwar. This is towards the Gomukh Glacier and this is towards Bay of Bengal. You see here, this is the main river. A barrage, Bhimgoda barrage, is built on this river. Water is diverted through this canal and this canal. So whoever has visited has taken a dip at Haki Pauri, and sadly, I might disclose this to you that this, where the place where you have taken dip is not the river, Ganga River, it is the canal you must have taken a dip. The actual river is all dried up here. So this is what we do when we are talking about agriculture versus conservation. We have diverted more than 80% of water. Basically, we have diverted 90% of water from these barrages and canals for human use, but at the cost of conservation or at the cost of other ecological functions and processes that are still understudied, and those processes are responsible for actual ecosystem services or benefits. Now, why? What is behind this all? Multi-sectoral policies or ministry policies that are impacting Ganga is the reason behind that, because these policies, they have different impact on Ganga River. If we leave apart policies of Ministry of Environment and Forest, which are supportive of conservation, there are policies of Ministry of Agriculture, Shipping and Hydropower, which have exploitative effect on Ganga River. Exploitative effect means that they are trading off by taking away maximum water and leaving Ganga dry through their policies. In terms of policy, I would say that one of other reasons or challenges for mainstream benefit is the lack of information, the lack of market, and lack of or weak regulatory failures. When we talk about information failure, it is basically people don't know about the value of ecosystem. We don't know about the processes behind these services that we are deriving from these natural resources, Ganga in this case. And the introductory slides, they gave you information on species and habitat needs, and yet we don't know the ecosystem processes behind them. That is information failure. And even if we don't know as ecologists or scientists, this information is not amongst the policy makers or even the common people who are actually getting benefit from the Ganga River. They need to have this kind of information so that they can make informed choices. Then we have market failure, where pricing mechanisms or pricing in the market do not actually reflect market value, for example, of soil fertility. If we go and talk to policymakers and say soil fertility should be one of the highest charged or priced services from Ganga River, start laughing. So if we talk about maintaining population habitat, it should be charged highly, they'll start laughing because we cannot value them. They are priceless. And it's not also ethical to price them. Similarly, the case of market failure is, for example, since we are talking about tourism webinar, the culture tourism or nature tourism, the true prices are not reflected. The benefit that people who are associated with tourism that they get at the local level are minuscule compared to what goes down under the chain of transactions between the tourist and the benefiters. So this kind of things is termed as monetary leakage, in case of tourism. where money is being spent by tourists, but the actual amount that is reached or reaches the local people is very minuscule. So as people who are involved in tourism or ecotourism, there is a need to minimize these monetary leakages. Example of Bhutan is one of the cases. Bhutan is one of the perfect example where they have started doing that long back, where they focus on low impact, high value, where they allow very few people, but those people, they ensure that those few people pay maximum money that they can. And another thing is that why local people don't get benefit, because we have local people, they're working usually as waiters or guides, but they are not the actual owners of those business. So they don't actually get the particular benefit. Coming to the regulatory failure, we have policies which provides protection to our natural resources, but they are weak. And these acts provide protection to our those particular areas which are high in biodiversity, and they are also known as protected areas, national parks, sanctuary, community and conservation reserves. So how do we tackle these challenges? We need to tackle information failure through solid science and effective translation into practice. That we are trying to do in Ganga project also. Ganga project is a very big project which has lot many components, and disseminating this information to finding out the species assemblage and then disseminating this information to the public is one way out of making informed choices. Then how do we deal market failure? By putting higher market value to ecosystem goods and services. For example, water, we do not pay actual value for the water. We pay water tax or water cess. We don't pay actual value of water. We don't pay it by volume use of water. It is only in the state of New Delhi that water pricing is according to the volume of water used. So this is a must if you want to save rivers, not particular Ganga river, but other rivers. Then another is polluters pay, where we put taxes on polluters who are people who are polluting the river, especially the industries. And then we talk about payment for ecosystem services, where those who are actually conserving the ecosystem, riverine ecosystem, are being paid by downstream communities who are getting benefited. Again, these examples have to be drawn site specific. If we say one payment for ecosystem service model will work for the entire Ganga, it will not, because Ganga is a diverse river. It is a dynamic and diverse river with a lot many stakeholders involved. So all these models have to be very site specific. How we deal with regulatory failures? By implementing stricter regulation for protection and policies which are coherent with each other and ecosystem oriented rather than extraction oriented. So this first diagram, it shows the present situation. Present situation as in when there are lot many dams and barrages in the Ganga river, or basically the river is regulated. When the Ganga would not on any other, in case of unregulated river, all these red would have gone and all these green petals would be larger and bigger. But because Ganga is a regulated river and we allow extraction of resources, so we have bigger petals out towards trade-offs and less smaller petals at the synergistic services. But if we keep situation like this, if we keep going on like this, then all these services will diminish. You can see even nature and culture tourism services, they would decrease because the river beds would dry. People would not go to the banks of Ganga River to do aarti and all. They will not go to the riverbed which is dry. They will not go to the landscapes which are no more green. So what do we do? This is the desired situation that we need to go through. We need to regulate extraction of resources by putting higher prices, and people don't think that these things are for free. These things are not for free. There are other organisms on this planet Earth which are working for provisioning of these services. So we as humans, as the wisest creature on the Earth, so-called wisest creature on the Earth, we need to think of these synergies and the processes which are happening, and we need to regulate these. And with this, I would say thank you. And if you have any questions, so all questions and comments, they're welcome.
Hi, thank you, ma'am. I think we have questions from Christy. Creating dead bodies, cremating dead bodies in the bank of Ganga is very famous. So, do the local communities, they are taking any responsibility or precautions to prevent the pollution from these rituals?
See, cremating bodies is a very sensitive issue, especially with the Hindu culture or religion. Though electric crematorium has been built by National Mission for Clean Ganga along the banks of Ganga, but willingness to adopt electronic crematorium is very limited as for now. But people are being oriented, especially forget about the local people or the native people. They will not forget easily give that up. But at least we educated class, we so-called educated class, we can give that up.
And the second question is Ganga River polluted? So how is the current situation after this lockdown? That would be a correct question, I think.
After the lockdown, a lot has improved, but even there is a misconception that Ganga River is polluted. Ganga River is not as polluted as the Yamuna River, and the surveys that our research team has done so far, they found about that 49% of the Ganga River still has good habitat, good biodiversity value, and good biodiversity value, it means the Ganga is clean.
So I have a question. This is regarding the gharial. So they have, I think, a restricted area for egg laying. I forgot that sanctuary over. So is there any mining activity or is the egg laying that area is under threat for gharial breeding?
Oh yes, mining is rampant throughout the Ganga River.
Okay.
But what has happened is that since we have made the it's been fourth year of the project that the project has started, and about we have reached about 70,000 people along the Ganga River. So we have raised awareness of those people, and because of that raised awareness, those local communities, they are coming forward and they are informing the forest department and our organization in case they find any eggs around. And sometimes those sand mining activities, it has not stopped at all. It is still going on. But these local communities, they rescue even though turtles also. So we go and negotiate with them that at least during the breeding season or the nesting season, such kind of activity should not happen. Or if they happen, their skill should be at least minimal.
One question is there on payment of ecosystem service. Can you hear me?
Beesh, no, I cannot hear you properly.
Okay, so this is regarding the payment of ecosystem service. Hello?
Yes, this is regarding payment of ecosystem service, right?
So whether the people living in the lower stream are willing to pay for the ecosystem service, whether that will be ever possible in India?
So, Beesh, we are actually trying to develop a model for payment of ecosystem service, and it is, as I said earlier, it's very site-specific. So, we are talking in terms of villages, not even a lower stretch. We are talking about villages that will be getting benefit, and those who would be, like, for example, Varanasi city. So, people of Varanasi city, if they are willing to pay communities which are upstream or villages which are upstream. So we are still in a development phase. We are trying to develop a model, and then we'll test the model.
So one person like 478331. You are allowed to talk. Do you have any question?
Okay, myself, yeah. Dr. Amit Tiwari. You are. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes. We can hear you.
Okay. Yes. Okay. My question, I am from Kanpur. In Kanpur, River Ganga facing very high pollution load as well as population load. What type of work conduct in meantime in coming future, WII in conserving biodiversity in Kanpur and adjoining area?
See, Kanpur is polluted. Problem in Kanpur is basically because of industries. And our survey teams have found that if there is another problem associated with that, and that is the flow in the Ganga River. The flow is very minimal along the Ganga in the stretch between Narora and Kanpur because the water is diverted from upper parallel lower Ganga canal and the upper Ganga parallel canal. So despite that, we found dolphins in that stretch between Narora and Kanpur. So we are, and we have done all ecotoxicological studies also, which found that there are obviously lot many toxics in the water, the toxic element in the water. And we have submitted this report. We will be submitting this report to National Mission for Clean Ganga. So our first recommendation is obviously to increase the flow by releasing more water in the Ganga River, which they themselves have been said to do through this e-flow notification of National Mission for Clean Ganga.
Okay. Mr. Padanaswamy.
Madam. Oh.
Yes.
In Kanpur, Ganga barrage is also situated.
Right.
They capture a lot of water.
Right.
They also affect in biodiversity in Kanpur zone and adjoining area.
Right.
What type of effect in Ganga biodiversity?
See, it is
that only, barrage.
See that because of that barrage, the species are able to move upward migration and downstream migration has stopped. So we have done genetic analysis to see if there is any changes in genetic structure of the population upstream of those barrages and downstream of those barrages. So far, we have not, the species that we have studied, especially the turtle species, we have not found any genetic structural changes or diversity changes in these particular species. Only in the because of Tihri Dam, we found that the structural diversity in Golden Mahasheer has changed in the upper stretch because of Tihri Dam and dam at Alaknanda Dam, not because of barrages and other barriers in Kanpur, even in Narora. First reason is because these barrages, they allow upward and downstream migration during monsoon season. In monsoon, there is enough water for these species to move around, and these barrages, they also have gates which open during monsoon season. So as such, there is no problem to diversity because of these barrages in the Ganga River, especially in the lower, middle and lower stretch.
Thank you, madam.
Welcome.
One HX91, can you speak?
Hello.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, my name is Ashish. I am from Delhi.
Right.
And my question is this: that please, ma'am, can you, ma'am, where is Ganga from? Unmute. Where is the Ganga from? Organites.
Ganga originates from Gomuk in Uttarakhand state.
Okay, ma'am. So, ma'am, another question. Hello.
Yes. Yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay, ma'am. So, ma'am, I want to speak that, ma'am. Can you please speak in Hindi in another webinar?
Okay, so I'm so sorry. I did not know that people were from. I thought mostly people would be from South India. So I.
Yeah, ma'am.
Talking in English. मैं अगली बार से हिंदी में पक्का बोलूँगी. मुझे कोई problem नहीं है हिंदी में बोलने.
Okay, ma'am. Please अगली बार से कोशिश करिएगा क्योंकि ma'am समझ में नहीं आता थोड़ा बहुत.
आपको जो पूछना है पूछ सकते हैं. अभी भी कोई problem नहीं
है. ठीक है ma'am. Thank you ma'am.
Welcome.
Ma'am, actually the people are not just from South India. It's all over India. Even from abroad.
But English is a universal language, so I thought that would be people yes, would ma'am. Be. Comfortable with that anyways.
Sure. So ma'am, the next question would be like what might be the alternative for dams in order to survive agriculture and conservation of nature, of course.
For now, there is no only alternative would be other sources of energy, for example, renewable sources, be it solar,
Thank you.
But then these kind of sources of energy, they also have a downfall. None of these renewable energy sources, they are free of any fault. So we have to choose between the lesser devil.
So, Parani Sami, he has raised hand, but is not speaking. I think that's it, ma'am. We don't have any more questions from the participants. So, do you have any more questions? No, you're mute. You're on mute.
Okay, yeah. So, now, you know, there are so many barriers, you know, dams are there in between. You also showed that the water from Haridwar is being diverted to towards the channel. So, how are we going to tackle this issue in future? Because again, there will be a the fish migration will be again affected by these old big dams. So, how are we going to address this issue in future? Because the dams are created for hydroelectricity. I mean, still not.
So, we are talking about we are talking about fish ladders and other fish passes that the designs are there already, which have been implemented in European countries. So, we are thinking of feasibility of that in terms. When we talk about feasibility, it's basically monetary feasibility to the authorities who are running those dams. So, in
what
future,
the ecosystem service, when the dam is created, they are actually blocking the water downstream. It's again altering the ecosystem service. So, whether they are ready to pay for that, the people who are running these big dams and other things.
It's a tricky question.
So,
but then how much amount they should be paying? We don't have calculation for that. See, our information is incomplete. Even if we ask them if they are ready to pay, and if they are ready to pay, how much should we be asking? We cannot compensate for the service which is already lost. We can only think of try ways of recreating it, or like not repeating the mistakes, basically.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, even for recreating, we need to allow the flow, right? Already the dam is in place, so how can we recreate the scenario?
Subish cannot hear you properly.
No, actually, if we need to make a changes, we need to allow the flow to happen again. But because of the dam, that will never happen. So
yes. So decommissioning of the dam, that is the hardest thing that we can do. But since India is on a development path, we cannot even think of it right now.
Loki?
Yeah. Hi, Rajesh.
Hi. Yeah, you can shoot your question. Yeah, you're on.
Yeah. Good evening to all. Subhash and Lokesh here from Chennai.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Okay.
Can you all hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah. The question about the dams. What might be the alternatives, ma'am? I mean, not in the source of energy, the source of water, I mean.
There could be smaller dams, which are less than 25 megawatts in their capacity. Smaller dams are the options. Smaller dams with efficient wildlife management techniques are the only option that we can take.
No, whether it would... Okay, that mean, I mean, I was about for asking for agriculture and other purposes, ma'am, instead of like sources what we gain from the dams. I'm talking about the water
is diverted from, so for agriculture there are not many options. First option is to start growing the original traditional crops which were less water intensive. So instead of sugarcane, which is very water intensive and highly commercially priced, we can replace them with the traditional millets. And these traditional millets, we should, as I mean, as a community and as community who is more interested in conservation, we should promote these kind of grains. So that was one option. Then micro irrigation that has been happening in other countries is another option, and minimizing losses which through this while transportation of water from river to the agriculture field. Minimizing that water loss through evaporation and transpiration is another option. All these are hardcore engineering solutions that can be done.
Yeah, I totally agree with that.
Sorry.
you have something you can talk. No, I had one more, just one more thing to ask.
I would like to add one more thing. Actually, okay. In our country, the wetlands are not given enough importance. So normally, what we think, wetlands are wasteland. Normally permitted, you know, the real estate people are building on that. So wetlands are very important for groundwater recharge. So if we can protect the wetland, that problem can be solved to an extent.
Right. Totally agree with you.
Yeah, in Chennai, you know about Pallikaranai.
Yeah.
I think they've reached.
Kerala has happened because of that only.
Yeah, I think they've reached Vedanangal now. So it's never ending. And yeah. We have to take care of the wetlands. And rainwater harvesting is one more thing, right?
Yes, that is one more thing.
Yeah, basically, those things have
to be for that only, no? They were traditionally used for harvesting water,
yes.
And all.
And almost, what about the check dams?
What about them?
What about check dams? You mentioned about dams, right? So check dams
basically help in it helps prevention of soil erosion. So check dams using local and natural material is okay. Instead of making hard, like concreted dams, check dams. You should use weird structure which are like eco-friendly.
My question is there any exotic species in Ganga which affects our native?
Yes, there are about 6 to 7 fish, exotic species of fishes, yeah. which is actually replacing the native fish species. And as I mentioned about the snow trout, which is the cold water native fish species, it is being replaced by another exotic fish species, which was actually promoted by the fisheries department. So here there is incoherence because of lack of knowledge.
But they are talking about the catfish, because there are some saying that the catfish is migrating up.
Yes.
So how are we tackling that? Because even in Pondicherry, there's still lake, you see a lot of catfishes which are affecting the native species.
It's very hard.
Also, we need to reach out to the farmers and also to the fisheries department to educate them not to promote these non-native species, because they would otherwise, we all know how they impact the native species.
Even in Periyar Tiger Reserve, there are so many native fishes, but you know, tilapia and the catfish has been not introduced actually, when there was a flood, the species came to the river. Now there is no way to control the population. Even though the native fish population is coming down, if the fishermen going, they are catching, but most of the time they are getting the catfish and the tilapia, not the native fish.
Okay, so I think most of the questions are, I think all the questions were answered. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot. It was very informative, and this energy what you showed in the slide, that's the most impressive one, because how we have maintained that cycle so that everything is going in a balance so that we can survive for long.
And
thank you all for giving me this opportunity.
Actually, it's our privilege, ma'am. Thanks a lot for coming and joining with us. It was a wonderful session. I think many of us enjoyed, because most of us never realized the importance of ecosystem service. So in between getting some likes on this service, it will be great thing. So thanks a lot for coming.
I'm grateful that they could gain something from this session.
Yes. Thank you. Sure. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, bye-bye. Good night.